Most games tend to avoid the early colonizing period, and for good reason. Sure, there's some horrific history and several atrocities that came as a result, but more importantly, these guns are slow as shit, and that's no fun. So in an aim to understand why the British Empire fucks everything up, I went back to Betryer, a game that is pretty much never talked about anymore, and to be honest, wasn't very talked about when it came out either. Set in an early Virginian colony, the main selling point of Betryer seemed to be slow guns and monochrome, which honestly isn't all that much of a selling point, but for some reason I bought this thing at full price when it came out, so there must be something to it. The first thing to note about the game is obviously its color scheme. Monochrome games are nothing new, and neither is the whole separating every color except one, but it is pretty striking. Just the bay at the start is pretty. It's like playing a Russian art film. They overdo it with the reflections on the water, but I suspect that's just to hide the edges of the playable area. You can even turn the monochrome off and change the level of contrast and just how much saturation you want, which kind of strikes me as pointless as it gets rid of the one thing that made the game stand out visually, but whatever. At least, it would be if the game didn't have some of the worst screen tearing I've ever seen. I don't know if this showed up in recording, but I had to play the first part of this with my screen essentially split down the middle, and it wasn't enough just to enable V-Sync. Turning it on didn't seem to do anything, so I had to look around, and for some reason it wasn't enabled in the config file, which seemed to fix it. I naively thought that that would be the end of the visual troubles, but no. Apparently this game really doesn't like AMD cards, specifically mine. So every overlaid effect, like the flashing to indicate important items, the outline of the spirits, and these god-awful mist effects look obnoxious as fuck. I tried to fix it, but apparently this is just a 5-year-old bug that stands pretty much no chance of being fixed, especially now since I'm fairly sure that Black Powder Games is no more. So if the footage is choppy and awful, then I'm sorry, there's not much I could do. Incidentally, Black Powder Games are comprised of some ex-Monolith people, so that's cool, though don't get your hopes up. Leaving the opening area prompts this red woman to shoot an introductory note at you, and you get the short bow, which is pretty much this game's way of negating the slow guns thing, because right from the start, your character can fire faster than fucking Legolas. This game was made during the great bow epidemic of the early to mid-2010s as well, where every game decided that having a bow was the new hot thing for some reason. I never really thought about how strange that trend actually was at the time. It just seemed like developers collectively lost their minds for a few years and decided that bows would bring in the money. After this, you encounter the first mob of the game, that being these strange possessed conquistadors. I suppose the Reconquista wasn't enough, so they spend the rest of the game trying to convert your face to no longer being on your body. Honestly, the difficulty in this game is a bit of a mixed bag though. I played through the whole game on its hardest difficulty and only really encountered trouble in the early stages. I didn't do the mode where you drop all your loot upon death though, since I wanted to maintain my sanity at least. But once you amass enough firearms to form a colony of your own, the game becomes dull, as enemies are no longer intimidating. The end boss fight can go fuck itself though, but more on that later. The game does have stealth mechanics that occasionally make things quite tense, but ultimately these moments are short-lived. The wind being one of them. You can move faster once the wind kicks up and hide your shots using it, which is an interesting mechanic for all of about 5 seconds once you realize that A, the combat isn't particularly hard to begin with to require stealth all that much, and B, it isn't all that fun anyway. It might seem like I'm down on this game, and you would be right, but I'll explain. Eventually, you make your way to a fort and find that everyone has been turned into Tate Modern sculptures, which is strange for a colony as I can't see a single person with polio. After searching around for clues, which you'll be doing pretty much for the entire game, and after digging up both the eyes, ears, and tongue of someone, you find that you can now see, hear, and talk to things that you couldn't before. The game is basically a murder mystery where you talk to ghosts. You would think this would make a very short-lived murder mystery, but the ghosts all have amnesia, which means you have to run around sticking bits of old shit in their face till they remember who they are and what happened. Sadly, this same tactic doesn't work in care homes. You do this by ringing bells in each area, which sends you to a strange nightmare version of the world where all the ghosts hang out. Doing so also brings in other enemies though, as the conquistadors have all been replaced with skeletons. Honestly, the enemy design for this game is universally shit, to the point where I'm beginning to think that the enemies might be unchanged assets. The difference between weird, crispy natives, knights, skeletons, and giant bugs for some reason is just strange, and makes the game feel like it was cobbled together, which, to be honest, it probably was. But this game does have one thing going for it, and that's atmosphere. Thank you. For a game as janky as it is, it seems to excel in creating a foreboding atmosphere. When you're stalking through woods listening out for the wailing mission objective and trying to avoid being spotted, there's a genuine texture to everything that makes you briefly forget the shit, but sadly, not for long. After visiting the spirit world for the first time, you'll be confronted by the same red woman from the start who claims she can't see the conquistadors all the ghosts, so you essentially just tell her about all the ghosts you've been talking to anyway, like a fucking madman. For some reason, after you discover what happened to a wraith, you can tell her about it, and she will universally throw shade at them for some reason. Not only that, but you can also huck all the shit that you find at her and come up with some bizarre explanation as to why you've given it to her. She tells you that the woman at the start was her twin and that she's looking for her, and that's pretty much all the setup you get. The rest of the game is spent going to an area, clearing everything on the map, and then talking to her about your day. It's not the most compelling gameplay loop in the world, but for some reason I felt compelled to carry on. There's something about a game where your only problems are talking to ghosts and taking the occasional pot shot at a skeleton. Going back to the combat, a large concentration of the gameplay is dedicated to clearing areas prior to being able to use them. The game has fast travel for a few areas, usually just the areas where the bells are, and to unlock the locations you'll have to clear them Ubisoft style. So these are usually the only areas where combat becomes at least slightly interesting, because it actively requires you to attack and defend rather than just survive Final Fantasy random encounters. Honestly, some of the fights can recreate scenes from The Revenant, as you duck and weave away from arrows and bullets desperately trying to reload your musket, but then something will ultimately happen to ruin that. I made a joke in the Eldritch review about enemies having enough brain power to move towards you in a straight line, and that's the same story here, except I would argue that the NPCs are actually dumber. If you hide behind a tree before a skeleton or conquistador takes a shot, they'll cancel the shot and get super confused. So the best way to avoid getting hit is just to sit behind a tree and keep moving from left to right, since they only try to flank you if you're out of line of sight. That's not to mention that you can straight up break melee enemies by standing on a rock that they can't jump to. Overall, the weapons that the game gives you are also a pretty mixed bag. While I genuinely respect a first-person shooter that tries to handle the logistics of colonial weaponry, don't expect realism from Betryer. Reload times are slow, but you can run around at full speed while you do it, so it's really not that much of an inconvenience. And the aforementioned bow has a fire rate so fast that it becomes necessary to complete the end boss fight, since they send so many enemies at you and the damage difference is negligible. Overall, you have a choice between bows, crossbows, pistols, and muskets, alongside some consumable items like bombs and tomahawks, but I don't have any footage of me using the tomahawks because I genuinely forgot that I had them. Muskets have longer range, but strangely tend to do less damage than pistols overall, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, but whatever. The pistols are probably going to see more use than the muskets if you end up giving this game a try, simply because of the reload time and the fact that the damage difference from the musket is just better. What you do end up using the musket for is rapidly switching from the pistol after you've fired it to avoid having to reload, but otherwise there isn't much point. The crossbow is useful as it does more damage than the bows, and like the bows you can retrieve your ammo, but it becomes redundant after a while because of the reload speed. Ammo retrieval is nice at the start of the game, but you can buy upgrades from the shop, which strangely has no keeper, except for the fact that he will leave you notes all the time. Makes me wonder why you can't just steal all his shit, but oh well. But either way, the upgrades you can actually get increase ammo capacity exclusively. And if you're like me, seeing a bunch of undiscovered loot locations on a map is like a red rag to a bull, so money isn't a problem in getting these.
The cash is easy to get.
Other than that, the only other thing to upgrade is your water skin, which you use for healing. You can't actually buy upgrades for it, instead you find them in much the same way as the Firekeeper souls in Dark Souls. But again, the fact that the map shows you where all the loot is means getting a fully upgraded water skin is pretty easy. The weapon feedback is pretty shit as well. The kickback is about as powerful as a mild sneeze and the animations are pretty rudimentary. Same story goes for the enemy types. I touched on it briefly and yeah, I think these could use some work. They seem completely dissonant from one another. To use a term only a pretentious dickhead would use, there's no cohesion between the mobs. That's not to mention the sound design of them either. About half of them just make animal noises. That isn't to put down all of the game's sound design. The ambience is pretty good when you're walking around, but otherwise it just strikes me as odd to just have unaltered animal noises for your ghost enemies. Same goes for the music. Overall, it's just the same looping ambient track, and the end credit theme isn't really anything to write home about. I wish I could give you some sort of linear explanation of the story as I'm going along, but the way this game is structured makes it difficult. The game isn't completely open-ended. I'm fairly sure you can just gun it for the Forbidden Woods right from the start of the game, though the endgame scenario probably won't trigger. You can complete any number of the Wraith missions in whichever order you like, and to be honest, you can completely skip some if you don't want to do them, though apparently that makes the end boss harder, which strikes me as odd as the end boss was already pretty fucking annoying even after I had made peace with all the Wraiths. I don't know. Maybe I just suck, which is very likely, actually. You would probably expect me to come back and say, oh, but the game's writing is really good. Otherwise, what reason did I have to play this game? What reason did I have to spend 10 plus hours doing everything in a game that has weak-ass gameplay and a bit of atmosphere? But honestly, no. The game's writing is mildly interesting at best. Some of the text is clunkily written, and the Red Woman's backstory monologue later on reads like speculative fiction that your 9-year-old niece got you to proofread. Some of them are good, though. I liked finding out about the false witch trial, and William Eastgrove's story was suitably bleak, but really I can't recommend this game for its writing. The horror elements seem to disappear under a layer of weird enemy choices, boring gameplay, and okay writing. If you want an example of how to do early colonial horror right, go and watch The Witch. It's great.
Fucking fight me, you cowards.
And here's the point where I have to ruin the story, which, I mean, if you really care about playing this game, then skip to here, I'll give you a minute. Okay, so the plot ends with you discovering that the Red Woman's sister is actually dead because she was banging the local population and got pregnant, and her puritanical father didn't like that, so decided to kill her. He cuts her throat and burns her in the forbidden part of the woods, and one giant-ass plot contrivance later, her anger manifests itself into some kind of supernatural force that turns all the people into stone except for her sister, and the forest all spooky. That's it, really. By the end of the game, you discover the truth and remind the other sister that she is in fact dead after talking to her father in the spooky version of the forest, and she agrees to help you put her at peace. We get to the end boss fight, where there are so many skeletons and floating skulls that it's like fucking Mardi Gras at the Paris catacombs, and you eventually beat her. But surprise, the sister tricked you and isn't quite ready to let her go yet. So she ends the game by transporting you to the Shadow Realm, where there are a bunch of giant spirits. Incidentally, I have read every note in the game, and still couldn't tell you what this was all about. It's not the worst idea in the world. In fact, I'm convinced you could probably rework this plot and make something quite compelling. But otherwise, it's kind of dull, and the cock tease at the end just doesn't work for me. You can do a shock twist ending, but the story has to earn it first. The game has a few other systems I could go over, mainly the charms and some additional weaponry stuff. The charms are like little equipable buffs that give you minor increases to things like damage, reload speed, and health. Emphasis on the minor, since I can't remember ever seeing a notable change because I equipped one of these things. Additionally, you can find named weapons later on in the game that are always the better option, since they usually do the most damage and have some more buffs attached to them. But again, these aren't that noticeable, at least not to me. The repeating mission types are also pretty irritating, as every location just requires you to do the same bullshit over and over again. God, this really is an Ubisoft game. The Silver Skull missions in particular are a prime example, and having to clear the area of corruption beforehand can become very irritating. The game seems to want to go for an open world approach, but the world is neither open nor any type of world particularly. The areas all look the same, which I guess can't be helped since it's just one big forest, but the areas aren't varied enough to let you know where you are. The most interesting environments in this game are at the beginning with the shoreline, and at the end with the burnt forest. Everything else in between is just trees with a fort in the middle of it, and things on the map are often far closer than they appear to be on the map, making the explorable area pretty compact. If you do end up playing this game, and again, I'm not entirely sure why you would after everything I've just said about it, then I would at least recommend holding off on using the crossbow. It is better for small mobs and stealthing about, but when it comes to the end boss fight or any really large showdown, you want the fire rate of the longbow. The short bow is faster, but not by much, so might as well take the extra damage increase. The collectathon aspect of the game can also be annoying. I would recommend getting everything just to appease your need to rid the map of location and objective markers, if you're a Pavlovian test subject like I am. So that's Betryer, a conflicting mess that I don't think ever fully left early access, but for some reason I still wanted to play more of it, and sadly I'm fairly certain that Black Powder Games could have made something really good after this. Growing pains are nothing new with any type of production or games company, but I don't think it's likely to come to any fruition. The website is dead and the team hasn't updated anything in years. As far as I can tell, there is no formal acknowledgement of the company going under, which is kind of sad really. Like the colonists in Betryer themselves, the company seems to have just disappeared, and what's left is this. You can get the game for $3.99 in the UK, I'm not sure about the US price, so really trying it isn't exactly a great investment. Just be prepared to be bored and frustrated, but at least a little captivated by what is essentially a shipwreck of potential that will likely never be explored further. Sorry for the downer there.